I would say don't quit. No matter what challenges you are, you got to try. And if you don't try, that's your own fault. Because I see people that are young and they just don't want to work or something. It's like, to get better at something, you have to. I didn't move here for nothing. I didn't. And I'm not going to quit. I know there's drummers that can eat me alive, but I know I'm going to get there. I just got to keep going for it.
Hey everybody, welcome to Nashville Drummers Podcast, episode 18.
Today's guest is Brandon Garza, also known as Critter. And Brandon has been one of our really great supporters of the podcast since episode one, since the beginning. Such a great guy, and we were super glad to finally get him on.
Yeah, he is, you'd call Brandon a go-getter. So this comes up in the podcast, so I guess spoiler alert. With each and every person we've interviewed, he has taken them out to coffee and just hung out with them and picked their brain.
Yeah, I couldn't believe that. That was so cool to hear.
That's such a smart move.
Because we hear that advice a lot, right? Like, talk to the people that are doing things you want to be doing.
Right.
And that's kind of cool that we're providing that platform. And he's taking it. He's doing what we're kind of intending.
Right. Yeah, there are a lot of people who talk the talk, but he's walking the walk. In this interview, we talked a lot about overcoming adversity, and this guy's been through some serious stuff. And in fact, to be honest, is currently going through some stuff. His place just flooded. He had to pick up a whole bunch of extra gigs in order just to get his place fixed. And he told me a few days ago, he's like, yeah, man, it's just getting fixed up, man. So it should be done about right now.
That's so great to hear.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was definitely really inspiring hearing Brandon talk about a lot of the challenges he's been through, and not just getting through them, but just his really positive mindset that he's had throughout his life. We also discuss his relationship with Bernard Purdie, one of his favorite drummers, who has since become a mentor to Brandon, and we go through some pretty cool stories with Bernard as well.
We hope you enjoy episode 18 of the Nashville Drummers Podcast, which is brought to you by Music Lab Nashville. Serving the Nashville, Brentwood, and Franklin areas, Music Lab Nashville offers comprehensive hands-on music lessons in contemporary techniques and styles. Students learn from the most qualified instructors in the state-of-the-art practice and performance settings. All ages, all styles, all levels. Visit nashville.musiclab.co to learn more and to sign up for a free trial lesson.
Where does Critter come from? Where's that nickname come from?
So it was like a band that I played with, my Christian band back home in Minnesota.
Okay.
And one day when I was younger, in my 20s, I have a video of me like trying to break the snare head at this show. And then the snare, like the stick popped up, hit me in the face.
Oh!
And then the guy was like, dude, you're like Animal. And I was like, well, I got tattooed Animal on my arm. And they're like, it's Critter. And then it just like went like wildfire.
Yeah, it just stuck.
You've seen the little emblem I have?
I think so,
on the Instagram, the little guy that has the dreadlocks. You know?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was like, dude,
it's like
why?
You as an emoji or something.
So I was like, might as well just roll with it. It's stuck.
Hey, like man, it. If it comes out naturally.
Yeah.
I never try to force a nickname.
Yeah.
That's about as awkward. Actually, I think that might be the most awkward thing possible.
Yeah.
I go, you know, people call me such and such. No one calls you that, dude. Nobody. No. Like, but yeah, you're like.
Everybody on Broadway knows me as that.
Yeah.
Like.
Well, kind of fits as a drummer, right? Being an animal, like that's kind of a good thing. Like you're, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sticks are signed that way. So I was like, I'll just roll.
There could be definitely a worse nickname.
Yeah.
Well, it's dope too. Because again, if you are signing something, a drumstick, a drum head, whatever, just put Crit. You don't have to write your whole name out.
Actually, my stick is actually engraved. Like the guy I work with, he has a burner and he engraves. Like, so like when we talk about the whole Bernard thing and how that happened.
Yeah.
Like I signed it, but now it's actually burnt in. Lasered.
Yeah, nice.
So I gave some out a couple of days ago. I'm like, is this really your signature? Can I have your signature? She's like, you already have it. I'm not signing it again.
Yeah.
Also, I mean,
it's awesome.
I'm not doing it again.
So, yeah.
Dude, I'm glad you're finally here. This has been kind of a long time coming.
Very long time. Yeah. For the record, you know, Brandon has been probably one of our biggest supporters of what Nay and I are doing since we started this whole project. I know for me, like, after every episode, I get a text from Brandon. And I always appreciate that. He's always saying, I really enjoying the episode, almost done with it. Keep it up. Keep up the good work.
Yeah.
So that's pretty awesome. So And of course, Brandon was the winner of our free drum head giveaway here. So we just more reason to get him into the studio.
And we've got it here, right?
We got it here. Yeah, we just got to sign it.
So should we start at the beginning?
When were you born and where?
Yeah.
Describe that day.
Can you describe
your conception? How far back did you meet? Yeah.
Actually, okay.
This is going to be one of those episodes, I can tell.
I can describe my conception. I don't want to.
Okay, so past that, you're from Minnesota, is that
what
you
said? No,
Idaho. Idaho, okay.
Yeah, Idaho.
You've only been in Nashville, what, 2 years?
2 years.
Pretty new?
Yeah, just like a week was 2 years, yeah.
Wow, cool.
Yeah, so Idaho, born, my dad played music my whole life, which is funny because like you hear the stories like, hey, did you play drums? No. I hit like coffee pints, yeah, you know, and stuff like that. And then like my dad's drummer would be, and I would do it. Actually, I was a big wrestler. I was third in the nation.
Oh, wow.
I can almost coach Olympic teams right now.
No kidding.
Yeah, my coach was an Olympic coach. My parents would go on vacation and I would just go to camps and wrestle. And then my senior year, I got dropped on my neck.
Damn.
Ended the career.
Jeez.
And so I was like, man, like I couldn't feel from my neck down for like 5 minutes. And it was just a stupid little throw that the guy did. I loved wrestling. And then I was
You said this is in high school?
Yeah, this was my high school year.
Okay.
And I was like, man, like the guy, like I got the feeling back and they're like, hey, here's the deal, man. Like if you get dropped, you could be permanent. And I was like, okay, we're done.
Yeah. No need to do that again.
You know, like, and I love the sport. I love MMA. It's like my favorite, like, but I just,
we need to watch some fights together, man.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So basically, yeah, I was like, I want to start drumming. You know, I saw this, I used to call them band geeks. No, that's horrible. My sister was a band geek.
I'm a proud band geek.
I wish that's a nice term. Yeah. I'm not gonna lie. I don't regret anything, but then there's times when I'm like, man, I wish I would have done it.
Yeah.
Now I'm trying to learn how to read it and do all this stuff. Yep. And it's like, this sucks. Like for me at the age, it's like, because like I see dudes down in Broadway, like doing those doubles and stuff. And I'm like, I can't do that. I'm just a 2-4 pocket player. Keep it simple.
Sure.
So I begged my mom for this drum set. She was like, not happening. She's like, we're not putting a drum set. So I went to her mom, which was my grandmother. And I saw this Tom a Rockstar kit, which I have to this day still, at a pawn shop. And I begged her and she bought it. My mom was mad. And I just, boom. Yeah.
So done. I want to back it up a second.
Yeah, yeah.
So after the wrestling incident, were you already kind of into the drums or like?
No.
Kind of talk us through that transition of like, okay, you're done with wrestling.
Yeah.
And how did you then turn to music?
There was this kid that I used to hang out with. I used to skateboard a lot. And, he had this like little Ludwig kit and he was doing like the triplets, you know, thing, whatever. Yeah. And I was like, man, that's so cool how you do that. And I remember I was trying to play, you know, I couldn't play to save my life. Like I wanted to be in a band so bad at that time. And I remember getting the drum set, playing it, not knowing what I was doing. You know, they came with the set came with a minor cymbal. Like, I don't remember what it was, a big 18 inch and then some hats. I didn't know what minor even was.
Yeah.
And at the time, I did a lot of Christian music. Both my bands were Christian bands for 10 years. I did one in Idaho for 10 years and one in Minnesota for 10 years.
Yeah.
I remember my wife at the time, her family was our youth leaders. And so they had a drum set in the church. And I was like, I'm going to go down there when they're, and I would bang and they were like, please tell your boyfriend to get off the drums. He sucks. Like, it's annoying.
Jeez.
And so I was trying to find at the time in Idaho somebody to teach me.
That was the pastor that said that, right?
Yeah, my youth pastor. Yeah, my actual father.
Oh, was it really?
Yeah, that's my father.
No, I would say that. I was like, okay.
No, my father-in-law.
I didn't mean to make a joke about that.
No.
I was like, I'm picturing these like, you know, very religious Catholics. That
No. This was like a very charismatic church, which I was like, you should be used to this. You guys are a bunch of running around. But yeah, so there was a guy that was a jazz professor or whatever you call that, you know. And I was like, my mom was like, I'm not paying for lessons. So figure it out. And so I begged the guy. I was like, hey, man, I'll clean your house. I'll scrape things to learn. He'd have me work like 3-4 hours and then give me a 10-minute drum lesson. Mm. And then one day he was like, dude, you suck. And I was like, okay, cool. And so I literally, one of my good friends, Mike Middleton, which to this day I talked to him, he's like, dude, you're actually doing what I wanted to do. They had a band called Deluge. I was so bad that wanted to be in a band. I didn't care what I was doing. I didn't care if I was wrapping cables, dude. I was like, dude, I just want to be a part of a band.
Yeah.
And they're like, one day you're going to get it. So
in that kind of mindset, what was it about the band? Was it just like having your best friends or the music itself?
I don't even know. I don't honestly can't. Yeah. Like as a kid, my dad used to play music my whole life.
Yeah.
And like my dad just came over here last year. He's 83. And I talked him into playing La Bamba with us. He didn't want to do it. He's got dementia.
Oh, wow.
And at first he was like, I took him down to Broadway. That was a miserable thing. He walked up to the guy. He's like, you call yourself a musician? I was like, dude, just keep quiet,
yeah,
and just enjoy this, Dad. I just liked, like, as I remember as a kid, hitting things, you know, the drums are always fun to me. Like, you got to make noise. And
yeah, that's how it was for me. We were talking before you came in. It was like,
yeah, like pots and pans. And like, I remember sitting on his drummer's lap and hitting things. And it was like, this is cool. I don't remember. It never even occurred to my brain as growing up. My sister was a clarinet player. I was just like a wrestler. And I was like, man, I don't care. I don't know what it was that brought me back to it. It was just watching this kid play this triplet. And then I was like, I got to get a drum set.
Something clicked.
Yeah. It's something that was like there. It was like,
I feel like we've all had that moment. I mean, yeah. We may not even, it may not be tangible, you know, in our memories.
Well, that's like, you're kind of saying that was the moment. I don't know why. I mean, it's the same for me. My dad was a musician as well. And, and so I was always around it. But I remember the day that he was playing at my church and I grabbed the drummer's sticks from his bag and started banging on the walls. And then I was like, I want to do this.
Yeah.
I'm like, that was the moment. Like, it's for you, it's the triplets. Like, and I don't know why it was that moment. You don't know why it was that moment.
No, dude, it was
great. But that was it.
And I remember we started a band and they put me as a singer and I hated it. I was like, why can't I be the drummer? He's like, because you suck. He was right. I did. I didn't know how to do. I couldn't even keep a beat, you know, but it was like, I wanted to go back to that instrument. And so getting that first kit, it was when we first started the band. It was hilarious. One of my best friends, his mom was like, could you please help my son do something? Because he was into pogo sticks and all this weird stuff. I was like, well, I need a bass player. I knew drums and bass were always, those are the two elements that you can't find those people that much.
Yeah.
Unless you're here, I guess. And we started this band. And I was so like dumb at the bass. Like, I didn't know what to do. We bought a guitar amp thinking it was a bass. And then we duct taped a mic and like I was like, I got a band. And it was just two of us. And they were like, you guys are stupid. you're not in a band yet.
Yeah.
And then it just started coming together. And we did it for 10 years. It was a Christian rock band. At the time, I had given my life to Christ. And I was like, this is going to suck. Because I used to listen to like Marilyn Manson, Pantera and all this stuff.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm going in to listen to hymns now. This is going to be stand up. And then this buddy was like, hey, dude, check out this band called Living Sacrifice.
Yeah.
And I was like, holy crap. That's what I want to do. And
we
didn't get that heavy.
Did you ever listen to August Burns?
They weren't around when I was around.
Oh, really?
It was like Blindside, Grip.
Oh, yeah.
Project 86.
Man, I forgot about Blindside. Yeah,
I'm seeing them this year.
Wow.
They're coming into the States. These bands were like, August Burns Red probably were little kids at the time.
Yeah. I just think of, I know Matt Griner is also, comes from that worship background.
Yeah, yeah. This dude gave me this CD called Living Sacrifice. The singer lives here. I don't know if you, have you ever heard of that band?
Yeah, no. I've never heard of them.
Phenomenal. And I was like, dude, this is Christian music. Holy smokes. And I just rent it. But I never got to play it that heavy.
Yeah.
And then it just kind of just developed. I started like, I don't know. I don't think even YouTube. Well, maybe it was around, but we didn't have the money for YouTube, like the internet.
Yeah.
So I was just like, my start was literally church, you know?
Yeah.
You know, in Broadway, people are like, man, I can't believe how light you play.
Mm.
Because like the church didn't have a cage. And they're like, hey, if you want to play here, you're going to have to play quiet.
Yeah.
And it actually helped me to be dynamic. Like I just played a show a couple Sundays ago with this one group and they were like on the main Tootsie stage.
Yeah.
And they're like, the drumming was phenomenal. Like you're quiet. You weren't overplaying. You weren't loud. And I was like, cool. And they're like, why do you do that? And I was like, because I was played at church and I wanted to play.
Yeah.
That was the only way I could play. I didn't have anybody really to play with at the time until like the band started getting momentum a little bit.
Yeah.
So did that for 10 years. And then it was just like, we went into the studio. This is kind of funny. One of your episodes, there was a guy talking about the metronome. Do you remember that?
Yeah. That was Joe.
Yeah. And his story was the same as mine. Almost. There was a guy from Kenya. He was a drum professor. And we were in the studio getting ready to record the second record. I had no clue what a click track was. And I'm in there and this guy from Kenya comes in and like my guys are watching me and I'm getting ready to leave. And he grabbed me by the arm. He set me down and he was just like, hey man, if you don't like for 2 hours, he gave me this huge lecture. And he's like, if you don't take this seriously, you should literally quit playing drums.
Yeah.
And what was cool, what I learned.
2 hours?
Yeah. Like literally a 2 hour, like this is what you need to start doing. Da, 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 da. It was like a lecture, but it was also like, I'm going to teach you something here and you're going to listen.
Kind of like that fire.
Yeah. And my guys just sit there and then I walked out and I was like, we're not doing the record. And they're like, are you serious? And I was like, yep, there's this thing called a metronome and we're going to go play with it for a year. And what was cool about it and like something I think that I hope that the listeners get out of this that I think is important is, you know, I had two options. I could get really mad at this guy and say, who are you to tell me what I, you know,
right.
Or listen and grow from it. Mm-hmm. And I was just talking to this guy today. So I don't care if they're older than you or younger than you, if they have some kind of knowledge, you always can learn something.
Yeah.
So don't just like shut it down. Doesn't mean you have to take everything.
Yeah.
But listen, you know, and so I'm not saying I'm the best drummer in the world. I'm definitely not, but I believe my timing's there because of that.
Yeah.
You know, we just sat with the metronome and just went and went and went. And like, it was crazy cool. You know,
yeah. Man, I'm such a huge proponent. I love what you're saying.
Yeah.
I'm such a huge proponent of listening when people give you serious critiques. And even like if they do it in an asshole-ish way, because sometimes your enemies will tell you something about yourself that your friends won't. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Sometimes your friends are, they don't want to hurt your feelings, or maybe they just don't even observe that part. Maybe it's like they've got a blindness to it. But having somebody that'll go, hey, you're messing this up, get this figured out.
Yeah.
That every time that has happened to me and I've accepted it and gone, okay, well, let me go work on that. It's been such a boon to my life.
Yeah, this dude was phenomenal. His name is Tim Mature. I mean, phenomenal player. He had a degree. He was in a band called Lester Silence. And his stuff was simple, but he knew how to play.
Yeah.
And he was just like, dude, seriously, like, play the metronome and quit playing.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. And it was the smartest thing I ever did. Like, legitimately, like, that was like, wow. Like, it took a lot to get used to that thing beeping.
Yeah.
I was like, this is weird, but it's helped me out here. Like, when somebody's like, hey, can you come play a gig with, like, tracks, you know?
Yeah.
I feel more comfortable playing with tracks than I do on Broadway.
Really?
I'm getting more confident, like the counts. I've never had to count people off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, like, that was the first thing that somebody was like, man, you got to be a little more confident with your count. I'm like, because I'm so used to having either the worship leader or somebody else. Or
like Ableton sing.
Yeah. Intro, two, three. And I'm like, four. Oh, this is sweet. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then diamond on the five. I'm like, yep, we're good. So, and then I just, man, I'll tell you, like, right when I got the drum set, I fell in love with it and I just, it was not stop. And I mean, I went 100 miles at it.
Yeah. Back to the church real quick.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you mentioned having that story about, you know, playing softly and like that's obviously influenced your current playing.
Mm-hmm.
What else have you sort of taken away from? Because we meet a lot of people, you know, that church background and it's served them, you know, super well. And even myself, I don't go to church actively, but I've played here in Nashville and that's been, I can, even just some like a few weekends, I can see like the impact that that can have. Tell us maybe more about what you kind of took away from playing in church.
It was weird. Like, it was definitely challenging because, like, I went to a really charismatic church. I remember one of the biggest, like, there was, like, a revival one time. And this dude put me on this drum kit and he's like, play a groove. And I just ripped it with a rock groove. And he's like, no. And he kept stopping me. It was embarrassing me. I was like, man, I just want to put a bag over my head. And then all of a sudden, I just kind of just chilled out and I threw this, like, tom fill. And that's always something that I've done. Like, one of my favorite drummers, Abe Cunningham from Deftones and Ray Luzier, their tom work is phenomenal.
Yeah.
And so I've thrown that into worship stuff.
Yeah.
Toms are big in church. I found that.
Yeah. And I threw this groove and he's like, that's it. And I swear we played that for 2 hours. I felt like it probably wasn't, but you know how those churches get
credit. Yes.
Yeah. And it was just going and going. And so I think for me, just, you know, with the churches, it's, you never know where you're going to go. So it helped me as a drummer to like, be able to listen really carefully. Like if I'm with somebody new, if I don't know the song, I'm really listening, like, in changes, and I follow really well, I feel like.
Yeah.
So that helped out. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that answered that.
Yeah, for sure.
You know,
yeah.
And then just, like you said, the dynamics of it, you know.
It's like anything, you know, just serving the song. I mean, in that case, serving more than just the music, but the people there and the community.
I'll be real. Like, the Hillsong stuff is the same thing over and over. Yeah, I can't do it. Like, it's cool, but, like, dude, I got tired of, like, build it up. I'm like, we're already at 110. Like, there's no more building it up. Yeah. I was like, I remember one time, like when we moved to Minnesota, there was a church and these guys just cranked. They were young kids and they brought me in. The worship leader brought me, like, my mother-in-law talked him into getting me on the worship team. And the youth pastor was like, hey, we're going to bring this guy in. And like the young kid goes, well, what if he sucks? And he's like, well, we just won't bring him back. And then when I got in, I was like, y'all need to turn down. That was the one thing I learned too from the guy from Kenya. He's like, y'all stop playing so loud in the room.
Yeah.
Bring everything down so you can hear each other. You don't need to play that loud. And then start to learn to listen to each other.
Yeah. Because then the parts that you want to be quote unquote loud will relatively be loud.
And so that was something they were shocked. I mean, everything went down. I could hear. And then you're not like if somebody's taking a part, you know, like if the keys or the singer, you're complimenting those people. It's not like one big ball of mud.
Yeah.
And so that's something I learned too in church too as well. Like, you know, just kind of.
Forgot where
serve the song. Yeah. Not, it's not about you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So you're in the church band for, worship band for about 10 years?
I actually had the Christian band called Living for Jesus. We did that for 10 years. And then the singer, we were getting ready to do another record. And I was so excited about it, but he just started like, I don't want to do it. And I was like, man, like, it just wasn't working for me. Idaho, it just started getting really weird. The rock group of Christians, like, they just didn't support us. Like, churches weren't supporting us. And it was like, man, like, this is not good. So I just told my wife, I was like, if you could move, where would you go? And she's like, I'd go back home. Minnesota is where she's from. Yep. So we moved, and I was bummed. You know, I didn't get to play for a while. The kit was put away. We had to live with my in-laws, which is, I was grateful for.
Yep.
And then I ran into the next group that was another step up. Mm-hmm. You know, we started playing more shows. Then we came here in 2015 to do a record. And that's, I was grateful. But like, for me, I hate spending money if we're not going to do anything with it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the two guys I worked with, they talked me into coming here working with a guy named Skid Mills. It's like one of the top producers. Mm-hmm. He's got his Grammy with Third Day. Have you heard of him?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Skid is off the hook. And I was like, you know, if we're going to do this, we're going to tour. I hadn't toured at all. And he was like, okay, yeah, we'll do it. I promise we'll tour. So we get here, we do the record. I fell in love with Nashville.
Yeah.
Skid was a whole nother animal. That was the first time I ever, we had all of our songs. We had five songs we were going to do. I remember going to the studio, and it was weird. They're like, hey, man, what kind of drum heads you want? And I was like, whatever's on the kit. And they're like, no, really. Like, we're going to go get all this stuff for you. And I was like, are you serious? Like, do I have to pay for that? Is that,
you know? I got to Venmo you back?
Yeah. And he was like, no. Like, and so I remember doing the one song, and he was like, I don't like that. Let's try this. And I was like, my brain couldn't comprehend what he was saying. He's like, okay, chart it out. And I was like, I don't know how to chart either. And then I just kind of wrote the parts, and then it clicked, and I walked back in the room, and I was like, that's why you get paid what you get paid.
Mm.
It was like, holy smokes.
It's a different level that you hadn't yet experienced.
No, like, because the studio we did in Idaho was just this little dinky thing. It had electric drum kit, and I was grateful for it. I still have the record.
Yep.
And there's sometimes I'll go back, and I'm like, oh my gosh, why would I do my snare like that? I put a marching snare head on it.
Oh, wow.
Like, to have that big old ping.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this
it'll pop,
is, yeah. Yeah, like, it was wretched. Like, I go back and listen, and I'm like, oh, like, I'm that's definitely
you need to send us that.
Yeah, it's so bad.
That's what we'll sample for your intro.
100%. Just the snare,
just
though.
Just the snare. Yeah. So like, Skid was, it was great, you know, like, and then we came back and we started getting these opportunities, like Disciple. We were playing with Disciple.
Okay.
And
yeah,
in Protest. And we got an opportunity to go to Germany, and they turned it down. And every gig that we were getting, like, these big things, and it was getting turned down, and I was like, I can't do this anymore. I started hating music. Mm-hmm. I really did. I was like, this isn't fun for me anymore. I'm not enjoying it. Mm-hmm. So I read my word every day, my Bible. I was sitting in there one morning early. I was getting ready to go to the garbage company. That's what I was working for. I was reading about King David and his son, or Jonathan, Saul's son. And it said that, like, Jonathan would step out and called out to God and said, hey, man, if you tell me to fight these guys with my armor bearer, I'll go do it. If not, I'm going to step back. And it was clear as crystal. Like, I just heard God say, when are you going to trust me and do what I called you to do? And I was like, okay. And I took off, called my wife. I said, I think we're supposed to move. And she's like, okay, well, let's pray about it some more. And we did. And then it just got to be where the band, I wasn't enjoying it anymore. Like, they come to my house. I hated practicing. I hated playing. We played the songs the same thing over and over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so I started
Felt stuck, it seems.
Like, oh, yeah. I was like, man, if something doesn't change, I don't know what I'm going to do with my life.
Yeah.
So I reached out to Joey from Disciple and some other guys, Bernard, at the time. I was like, what would you do? And he's like, they all said there's three places, L.A., New York, Nashville. Well, L.A. and New York were expensive, and it was cold. I was trying to get out of the weather. And I was like, I think we're supposed to move to Nashville. And then just kind of.
And you had already been here, so you was like.
Yeah, I brought my wife over for, we went to Notre Dame, a big football freak. Notre Dame is one of my favorite colleges. So we was like, hey, we should go there. Came here, watched Tenacious D play. That was fun.
Nice.
And my wife is an introvert. So she was like, I was going to bring a buddy. And she's like, well, where are we at? And I was like, we're right up front. Oh, she's like, awesome. Are you kidding me? And she just stood there. Like, it was comical. But we watched them. And then she's like, okay, let's move. And then just kind of.
Sounds like, I've never met your wife, but it sounds like she's been just your rock throughout all this. Like, super supportive.
Oh, my wife, dude, is unreal. Like, yeah. I mean, three houses I've taken over, you know, the first to the second to this one. She was a classical pianist at one point, and she just, you know, fell off it. She loves to read and stuff, but she's always like, I know you can do this, so let's just get you there.
Yeah.
And she knows that I've never let my family suffer. You know, I've had to work hard, you know, like, to get here. I was driving asphalt truck 17-hour days, Monday through Sunday.
Wow.
That was like challenging, you know, it was like just to get here.
Yeah.
And there's other challenges I've had. And that's what I try to tell people is like, no matter what challenges I've had, he's never failed me. It sucks sometimes. I've had to go through some real challenges in my life, you know, like last year and stuff like that.
Yeah, you're mentioning.
Yeah. But it's like, I keep pushing forward and hopefully somebody will see the worth in me. Sometimes I get discouraged, you know, like this is a whole different world here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whole different world. And I've noticed, like, I don't know, I'm trying to be rude, but there's not a lot of loyalty I find sometimes. Some people maybe.
Yeah.
But I've had the good and the bad.
Yeah.
You know.
What are you specifically feeling the lack of loyalty in?
So, like, one group I played, I won't mention the name, at the time. So, I started taking lessons with Jim Riley. Mm. I did take them with Dangle for a little bit and then over to Jim. Mm. And then it was weird. I was like, I had this one group and I learned how to chart the Nashville number system a little bit better. Like, Ethan, I met Ethan a long time ago. Ethan's a cool dude. Yeah, we started like, he's like, dude, try this method. And we started working together. And then Jim was like, yeah, you got to do this. Jim was intense. Like, I finally had to tell Jim, like, dude, I'm like a 4-year-old dude. Like, you can't just keep going, go, go. Like, I was like, bring it down. Like,
yeah.
Like, but I charted this one group and like, I felt like I did everything right. And because I don't drink, I'm straight edge. I don't drink and I do drugs. I got fired from the gig for not drinking.
Really?
Wow. Yeah. It's kind of a funny story. Like, if somebody's like, hey, have you ever been fired? I've been fired from not drinking. Like, yeah. Like, and I had all these
gigs. I don't do enough drugs to be with you.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. It was so weird. Cause like,
okay, you're hired now.
I was going to go to like, Vegas. It was my first flyout dates and I was super excited. I was like, this is awesome. And then came back from again. They're like, yeah, dude. They gave me some stupid story and I called him out on it. I was like, just be a man and tell me the truth.
Yeah.
Don't beat around a bush. Just tell me the truth. He's like, you don't drink and you're like a goody goody. And I was like, what are you talking about? Like,
do you see my arms?
Like, yeah. Like, it was just like, dude, just because I don't talk foul or something. I'm not perfect either, you know, but I just try to be a good person. And he was like, yeah. And it was like, you were trying to drive me drunk. Like, you know, with me in the car, I like my life. Like, if you want to drink, I'll drive us all.
I like, that's well put. I like my life. Yeah. No, thank you. Driving me around.
So it is what it is. And like I said, I think sometimes when I play with groups, I've had this happen. Now there's two groups that I've played with that they're like, hey man, we're not making you feel uncomfortable. I was like, dude, do whatever you guys want. I don't care. Like, if you want to drink, if you're trying to shoot like some hard drugs, I don't want to be a part of it. If you want to smoke dope, that's your choice. Like, just don't put it on me. And if you're going to drive, you give me those keys.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And so there's
doing something that's going to affect me.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So like, there's been a couple groups. Like, I went out with this one group, super cool dudes. They were like, you good over there? Because like, I was just watching all these drunk people and I'm having a good time. I played the gig. It was great. I said, dude, you guys stop worrying about me. I don't care what you do.
Yeah.
Just have fun. If that's what you want to do with your lives, I'm not. And they're like, that's just weird. Like, most Christians are like, they're
I feel like that. I feel like people have the wrong impression of what most Christians are like. They have no idea. Yeah, I just assumed that most Christians are this one. Like, most Christians are more like what you're describing.
Yeah. Like,
I'm
not going to tell you. I'm not God, so I can't judge you.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to. Like, the only time I'm going to be like, hey, I don't want a part of this is if I don't feel very uncomfortable, then I'm going to excuse myself out of the situation.
Yeah.
And so those have been the biggest challenges.
Yeah, and I'm sure that sucks in the moment, but it's kind of like you probably don't want to be a part of that anyway.
Yeah, I was devastated, man.
That's a tough way to find out.
And my wife's like, you don't need to be part of that.
Right.
Just keep trying, you know?
Yeah.
It's kind of like figuring out what you don't want to do first.
Yeah.
You know?
So,
you know, because they always say, and it's so totally a cliche at this point, but it's like, it's all about the hang out here. Like, are you a good hang? And that's like, and good hang really is, do you match? Like, that's so if you're in an environment like that where you're like, well, I don't drink, and they're like, well, we want somebody who's going to like party with us, and I'm like, well, then that's fine, I don't need to be a part of that. That's cool. Like,
I mean, like,
nice playing with you.
There has been some guys that I've worked with and they're like, dude, you're killer, like, we'll bring you back anytime, because you're not somebody that's judging me, you're not telling me, like, you're not condemning me, and I'm like, dude, it's not my place. I know my limits of hanging with somebody that makes you feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And if I don't like it, then I'll excuse myself.
Yeah.
So it shouldn't affect my playing is what and so far there's been a few groups that are like, hey man, you're playing. That's all we ask. Like, cool, whatever, you know? So,
yeah.
But, the record went, it was like one step closer with the one band. We did some music videos and then it was just like, I just couldn't do it anymore. Mm. And I gave up everything and still have the debt over my head and hoping that they would never. And it was 10 years of friendship. I'm not going to mention the name, but the whole friendship just went.
Yeah.
Wow. It was amazing how fast that you if you think you're trying to better yourself, and you tell somebody like, hey, man, I'm going to go do this. Some people will support you and some people will just like.
Yep. You'll find out who your real friends are in those moments.
That's right? So disappointing. Like mm-hmm. I always tell people, if somebody's like, hey, man, I've got this great opportunity. I'm like, go for it.
Yeah.
If that's really what you're doing, go for it. And like Dango really said something really cool to me. Do you guys know who Dango is?
Yeah.
Okay.
I haven't met him personally. I know he's at the, he did the Foo Fighters show.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know this person.
He plays for Scott Stapp from Creed and like Sonic. He's a believer. He played Ambrose Pacific. He was a punk drummer.
Okay.
And he's just a believer in Christ. Good. And he told me, he's like, dude, here's the deal, Critter. He's like, is your wife on board? Yep. Is God? Screw everybody else.
Yeah.
He's like, if your wife's on board, you're good, dude. Yeah. Right. You are good to go.
That's
goes wife.
Yeah, that's true.
Then God.
Yeah. So I was like, we're good, you know? So, cause I had so many people just like, you're going to fail. Touring's not where it, and I was like, I listened to it for so long until it just got to the point where I hated music.
Yeah.
And I was like, I got to do something different with my life. And Mike Middleton, the guy I was telling you back at home, he's like, you were made to do this, dude. You just got to keep pushing and grinding. So now we're here. And
it's been inspiring, even just sitting down now hearing your story. Like, you know, early on, it sounded like you had a lot of moments where people like literally just told you that you weren't cut out for it or like sucked.
Yeah.
Or in those moments, like, how have you really tried to like stay positive? I mean, it's easier said than done, right? I mean,
you know, honestly, it comes back to my wrestling background.
Yeah.
Wrestling for me, you in the MMA world too. Like my favorite fighter is Michael Bisping.
Yeah.
He's hilarious.
He is.
Dude gets his eye kicked out and he still goes after it.
You like that video we put up?
It's crazy, man. Like wrestling, it is a true thing. It really is. Wrestlers have just a different mindset. There's the determination. If you want it bad enough, and like you can be a team, but you don't have to be a team. Like I can go to the Nationals without my team.
Very individual.
And I remember as a kid, there was this popular kid. I wasn't a popular kid. And his parents were like, why does Garza get to be the varsity? Well, because you're beating your kid.
Yeah.
Well, he's popular. And coach was like, I don't care.
Yeah.
He's got to work at it.
Who gives a shit?
This is data now.
He just got destroyed by this kid.
Yeah. So that was like, for me, it was like, there's days when I think of it that way.
Yeah.
I really do. Like, it's a struggle. Okay. How do you get past it? You figure it out.
Yeah.
You surround yourself by good people. I'm learning as I go, you know, like who I should hang. And when I'm getting treated like crap, I make a note of the name.
Yeah.
And like, okay, shouldn't work with that person probably. Yeah. Or, you know, you know, and then try to get into another group. And I think Rich Redmond says, you know, like take people out to coffee, ask them. And I do that. Like I was telling Nate, I don't know if I told you this, but like every person that, oh, maybe I have told you guys this, every person that you've put on this podcast, I've reached out to.
That's so cool.
And I've taken them out. Yeah. Besides maybe two that couldn't do it. And I don't, you know, I was like, hey,
shame on you, whoever you two are.
I can tell you.
Go to coffee.
We're deleting your
episode. You've got time. No, I understand.
We're going to delete that episode.
Literally, I've had no time for anything, so I can't tell.
No, but I do it. And I'm not trying to, I've had people say, you're just probably doing it to gain.
Do you mean after the, like after the episode or just coincidence?
No, literally after I listen to the podcast, I'll reach out and I'll text you.
Yeah.
And then I'm not doing it because I'm trying to like get on here or I'm legitimately want friendship, like somebody that's actually going to value me and help me grow. I don't want something out of it. I'm not trying to gain something out of it.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to learn.
Yeah.
If something comes out of it, great.
Well, here's the thing about friendship. Friendship is a gain. And like there's the thing that's, I have this whole thing about selfishness. Like, okay, why do you do good deeds? You do good deeds because it feels good to do good deeds.
Yeah, yeah.
Like in a very good way. It's not like in a sickly way. Like you do things like, I did a good thing. That feels right. That feels good. If it felt bad, you wouldn't do it. Having friends feels good. That's the kind of gain that you absolutely like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be selfish in that way. Like, yes, I want real friends.
Yep.
I implore you, be that kind of selfish. Please. Please.
Well, back to what you were saying earlier, too, about like friendship, how like your true friends, it's obviously great to have true friends and best friends and that kind of thing, mm-hmm. but they're not the people that are always going to kind of give it to you straight.
Yeah.
Most of our, like, I think day-to-day friends are, to your point, like we are friends with people because it feels good. And they're not always going to pick fights with you or give you like, they're going to kind of tell you, you know, what you want to hear sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think it's important to have, to actively try to find friends or more like colleagues that will kind of be mentors and not be afraid to point out, you know, where you're lacking or things that areas where you can grow in.
Yeah,
sure.
What's that you said? You want to learn how to play drums, but you don't know where to begin? Let me humbly suggest to you that you head on down to Music Lab Nashville and you talk to their crew of fantastic teachers and you jump on in and start your music journey right there. Don't want to learn drums? Want to learn guitar? Ukulele? Mandolin? Trumpet? Vocals? Keys? Sitar? Maybe not sitar, but all that other stuff for sure. Visit nashville.musiclab.co to learn more and sign up for a free trial lesson.
So you're currently studying with Jim?
Not anymore.
Oh, not anymore. Okay.
No, after I quit my job, I was like, I couldn't afford it.
Gotcha. Have you, so someone that's, you know, been here for 2 years and, you know, you're, I think you really kind of embody like this whole community, like just grabbing coffee with people and just being super positive. How have you kind of navigated moving into a new city such as Nashville and starting to get gigs and just meeting people? And like, do you have active mentors now?
Yeah, I think my mentor would be obviously Bernard. Like I talked to him.
Mr. Here. Bernard Purdie?
Yes, sir. And then like,
who's that?
Bernard.
Yeah.
I want to get into that story too.
Yeah. Ethan is another one.
Ethan. Yeah.
Like when stuff like stuff that like, I don't know, like there's been times I was like, okay, what did I do wrong? Or, I mean, I've been burnt by several people. So I'm like, hey man, what do you think of this? And he's like, dude, no, don't put up with it. Or Brian Russell. I think that's the guy that put the Foo Fighters thing on. I think that's his last name. Is it?
It sounds familiar. I don't think I've met him.
Plays with Dylan Carmichael. I'll reach out to him and be like, hey man, what do you think of this? You know, or people that I know that's up in that up a lot higher than me that have gone maybe through those things. It kind of goes back to the guy that I said in the beginning from Kenya, you know?
Yeah.
And you can tell if somebody's being genuine or if they're like, that's the thing I like about the drumming community. We try to help each other out. Mm-hmm. You know, we really do. I'm pretty sure there's somebody out there that doesn't, but for the most part, they're like, hey man, you probably shouldn't do that because this is what's going to happen, you know? Like Dango's another one. Like he really helped me out my first gig. That was a nightmare. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a nightmare until the second part of the gig. It was Tootsie's. And, I got this gig and I was excited. And he's like, make sure you have felts and this cart thing. And I didn't have the cart thing. I went to Lowe's and I was coming down the hill from the Ryman. It caught and my snare started rolling down the hill. Oh! I was like, no. My water's going down the hill. I'm like, this is my first time coming in to that.
Oh.
And then the gig went great. And then I went to leave and this girl was like, hey man, our drummer's late. And I didn't realize that Pearl's clutches are not like Tama clutches. Sorry. I like Tama.
And, it's okay.
I was like, this sucks, dude. Yeah. And so this dude let me have the clutch. And then I jumped on the stage with this girl and she was just ruthless, man. Like she made me not want to play at all ever again on that stage. Like she was just like, you're doing this wrong. And then at one point I remember the guy turned and was like, hey man, if you can't get this, I'm actually a drummer. I can just finish it. And I was like, dude, you guys are putting like way too much on me. Just like chill. Yeah, and finally the bass player
was
like,
that the lead singer?
Yeah. And there was another guy.
Female.
And and this bass player's like, hey guys, I think this is his first time. Let's just like ease up. He's locking tempos. And I remember it was the Alan Jackson Chattahoochee.
Yeah.
I mean, she was stressing me out so much that I couldn't even do a train beat.
Yeah.
That's how nervous. That was how bad. I debauched the song.
Yeah.
And so finally when he kind of got the group to like, Mella, I found out that she had a breakup with a boyfriend.
Mm. Yeah.
It was like a weight just, okay, let me be me and let me just get us through this gig. And he's like, you guys should be a little bit more grateful. So I turned to several people after that and was like, hey, man, this is what happened. What did I do wrong? They're like, nothing. That person's a jerk. They shouldn't have done
that
to you.
That's not the norm here.
That's not how they should treat you. Like,
right.
And so I was like, okay, well, how do I avoid that? And he's like, it's kind of hard, you know? And so I was scared to play on Broadway. I didn't want to do it. I was like, I don't know if this is what I should be doing. And I had a regular job for a while. It took me to about 4 or 5 months till now to actually let go of the job and step out. And like, it's like I said, I really believe because of my faith, like if I'm obedient to God, he pushes me out. He's called me to be a drummer. And so I feel like when that happens, it's like he's going to either force you out. And then when that happens, like Satan's going to try to do everything he can to distract you, destroy you. And so that's kind of what happened back home. I got kind of pushed out, lost the whole friendship of the band. And then here it happened. I was working with this company. I used to work with people that have disabilities. Mm-hmm. I love that. You know, I have the autistic puzzle piece on my arm. They're people that are very important. They get abused a lot. Yeah. I've had to stick up for people. I've lost jobs for it because I've seen people get abused. Yeah. And I was working with this job here. And then we went out on the road and wrecked a tour bus and she didn't believe me. And so I had to take like pictures of it. And then it just got worse. And then it was like, okay, my wife's like, it's time to step out. let's go. And I started doing lift. And so like, I was asking people like, what am I doing wrong? Like I'd call Ethan up. I've called him up multiple times. I'm like, yo, dude, what am I doing wrong? Like, I don't understand. And he's like, dude, just people are jerks. Like you're a great dude.
Unfortunately, that's just the reality of the, yeah. of the business.
Yeah. Like, yeah. It's, and he's like, you're a great dude. And like, I'm not saying like Ethan and you and Nate and you guys are, I look up to you guys. Like, how can I get to your level? Cause you guys are animals. I try to get there. And like, sometimes I'm like, I'm glad I don't know all the chops. Cause I'd probably be like, probably lose a lot more gigs. I'm just a 2-4 dude. Like Bernard told me that, you know?
Yeah.
But I like, I don't know. Like I just like when those kind of things, I try to reach out to the guys that are, I see are a little higher than me and say, hey, how do I get to this? And they're like, okay, we'll do this. And like, if this happens again, don't work with the person.
Yeah.
You don't need to be treated that way. Your worth is more, you know?
Yeah, you really don't, man.
Yeah. So
there is no end to the people down here. You're like, okay, cool. You don't want to be easy to work with. Right on.
Yep.
You don't need to be worked with, period.
Yeah, exactly. And I've found out just recently, like, word of mouth goes fast around there.
It sure does.
And
this is the South, baby. Like, in all the good ways and all the bad ways, like, people will be nice to your face. But if you're messing up and, like you're being a dick, you will get blacklisted down here.
Yeah, yeah. Crazy story. This is the first time I ever walked off a stage on Broadway. And I called Ethan because I thought I literally burnt my name. There was a guy, I'm not going to mention his name, but he was with the Tootsie Circuit.
Yeah.
And I had got the gig. I found out like, if you're with that group, you can't go play other bars.
Yeah.
He did. He got caught, got canned. And I was like, man, I've been trying to get on Broadway and no one's picking me up. And I'm like, what do I suck? Like, what am I doing wrong? Do I need to cut my hair? Like, I was like, what am I doing wrong here? And so I thought, well, I'll just put a band together. There's got to be another way for me to play. So I got a hold of this guy. We get down there. We walk the strip. We went to every bar, got to Lucky Bastards. I went back a second time. The guy's like, dude, you're persistent, man. Like, let's get you in.
Yeah.
So I started working with this dude and I made an agreement like, hey, man, you know, I do some road stuff. I do like being on the road because like Broadway's fun, but after a while, it's nice to get away for a little bit, you know, and come back. And then he started giving my gigs away. And then he just turned into a real nasty jerk. And one day when I was on the stage, he turned around, he's like, shut your mouth and respect me when you're on my stage. And it was the wrong thing to say to me.
Yeah.
And I just blew. That was it. And I was like, I called Ethan right away. I was like, I think I just screwed myself. He's like, absolutely not. He's like, I can't believe you lasted as long as you did. He's like,
yeah,
I would have told him where to take a hike way sooner. And so I'm trying to learn that, not to be rude, but I let a lot of people walk over me, you know, and I hate it because I don't want to ruin my name, but I'm starting to learn like you can't be a pushover. You're worth something.
Yeah.
So
no, I'm the thing is, in those situations, I'm way not above letting someone know. I'm like, I will strike you in your face. Yeah. Like if you talk to me like that,
yeah.
Like on this stage, I can't
imagine saying that to somebody.
Oh dude. And there are some people down there who will, talk to you like that. Yeah. I'm like, no, you watch your mouth.
They won't even,
because I will slap you in the face.
I used to not be like that. I was telling Dan this, and hopefully this doesn't matter, but like I lost a twin sister to drugs last year. Hardest thing I've ever had to go through.
Wow.
I mean, she was a Marine, violence. I've had my life threatened. And so it changed, like cousins were involved. And so when I went back home and I found out that they're involved, I was like, you're out of the house. Don't come to my house. You're not welcome. Like, man, this is not the same Brandon we remember. I was like, well, no crap, dude.
Yeah.
Like,
I just went through this crazy,
like, look what you're protecting somebody that gave somebody. Ultimately, she chose to do it, unfortunately, but they walked.
Right.
And so, like, my perspective of, like, I usually, if somebody treats me rude, I warn you once, second time.
Yeah.
It's not nice. And then I feel horrible. I'm like, and my wife's like, you can't be that way. And I've got a good friend from the UK. He's military. He's like, dude, no. Don't let people treat you that way.
100%.
Yeah.
I mean, don't go and being rude and ignorant.
You don't have to be an ass. Like, it's okay to have that boundary. Like, this is where I will tell you exactly where my boundary is.
Yep.
And if you step over that again, that's going to be your problem. That's it.
Yeah. Yeah. And unfortunately, you know, like, I hate being that way now, but I have to be, you know, because I've been burnt so much last year. And I'm not saying woe is me, you know, but I'm just like, man, like I'm trying to figure out what I'm supposed to be doing. There's times I'm like, man, am I in the right spot? Should I quit playing drums? But I can't give it up. Yeah. It's in my blood.
And the wrestler mindset comes back.
Yeah, it's like, and like I'm 41 and it's like, man, I'm not going to quit playing.
Yeah.
Like I'm not, no matter what obstacle you throw at me, I'm going to figure out how to get to the next place.
Yeah.
It just has to happen.
Love it.
So, yeah.
You telling me that story reminded me of something that happened to me. I don't think I've ever talked to this on here. Maybe I have. I can't remember. But I played with a guy downtown, just one gig, and I was like, I was very green. And I told him, I was like, I don't know a bunch of these songs. Yeah. I'm like, so I just need you to direct me on some of these. He's like, yeah, okay. I was like, I would tell him, he'd start songs, not say what they were. Like, wouldn't even say what they were. Just go in, and never once turned around. Oh. Whole gig. and then wanted me for a bunch of gigs before that, and then just never called me again. I was like, dog, that was on you. Because I can follow. Pretty damn well. Like, I can follow real well.
Yeah, yeah.
But you didn't turn around once. You didn't even tell me what songs we're playing. We're like...
That's absurd. I've never heard of that.
That's insane. I've played with a guy just recently that was like that, and I'm like... What are we doing? He's like, follow. I'm like,
yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
And then he turns around and gives you this nasty look like, you're not doing the right beat. Well, how am I supposed to know the beat if you're not telling me, like, so I can at least reference something, you know?
Yeah, like, I played with my friend Dustin Kynes. When I first played with him, I told him, I was like, yeah, I don't know a bunch of these. He's like, don't even worry, man. He goes, I'm real verbal. I'm like, I'll direct you on it. Like, he's turned around going, like, train beat. He would be like, cha-cha-cha. Ga-ga-ga. Okay.
Yeah.
He knew how to communicate all of it. I'm like, oh, thank you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he was playing a bunch of country before I knew the tunes. Yeah. So
there's been a few guys that have been phenomenal like that, like with Sarah May's band, the one that I play with.
Yeah.
I love her. She's such a great person to work with. And her bass player is like, this one. I'm like, okay, cool. And then like, it's just, now I'm starting to figure out the dialect, I guess is what you call it down on Broadway. There's the right way, the wrong way.
And
I'm very OCD. I will like, I'm trying to learn how to chart and I dissect note for note, and Jim's like, don't do that. He's like, I would have never even done that on the record. Like,
yeah,
really? And he's like, no, you just go down there and play it. They don't care what you play. They're not gonna know. Now if you're with an artist, do it like the record, dude.
Yeah
a little bit different.
But it's like, I've learned that, like, I've played with several bands, like Sarah May's band, they do like the tempos like the record. There's a couple other groups that I play with, they're like blazing it. And I was like, one night we played with Sarah and I was like, dude, I feel like I'm just slow. And he's like, you're actually playing tempo. And I was like, so I'm having to learn now, like, this group does this way, this group does this way, this group didn't even do half the song.
Yeah. Like, and you got the ones that do all the medleys, right? You're
like, yeah.
Okay.
And I'm just like, this is insane down here. Like, it is really true.
That's like the beautiful thing about this city in Broadway specifically, you know, it's like, it's not just cookie cutter. It's, you got to be on your A game and it's all different.
Yeah.
That's the beautiful thing about it.
Yeah.
And memorizing all of those. All those differences between the bands, I'm like, that becomes a weird juggling act. I'm like, okay, so when I play Pour Some Sugar with this band, they do the whole bridge, but with this band, they cut out the first two bars of that and they just go straight into the heavy thing. I'm like, all right, okay, I can keep this all in my brains, but I know it's probably, I know a lot of people who want to chart, actually. You know, well, you would have reached out to Jeffrey.
Yes, I took him out to dinner.
Okay, yeah, awesome.
That dude's a monster.
And never called him back?
Never called him again.
I see him on Broadway here and there.
Bought him a nice steak.
We went to sushi, actually.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. He's filling in for me this next week, and he's all about the, like, having all these notes.
That's funny. I filled in for him a lot, too.
Yeah, I was like, dog, just jump in. You're good. Like, I'll give you notes on stuff. He's like, no, like, give me the full set list, like, on Spotify. I'm like,
that's how I am.
I promise you're good, bro. Just trust me. Like, I know how you can play.
Yeah.
Like, don't even worry about it.
Yeah.
No, I really want to take notes. I'm like, you do you, baby.
You've met Robert. He plays down on Broadway. He's in the Tootsie Circuit.
Robert.
I can't remember his name. Older gentleman. Phenomenal. He's a jazz guy.
See the guy with the glasses?
Maybe. He said the same thing to me, too. Like, it was weird. He's like, dude, I got to do it this way. He's like, dude, just go down there. You don't even have to. Just play.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's weird. And same with Sean Fuller. One time I was
Sean's awesome, dude. Yeah. What a good dude.
Yeah. Like, one time I got offered a 90s gig. I was like, I don't know 90s. And he's like, who cares?
Yeah.
Just go do it. I was like, I don't want to get somebody mad at me. That's what I got worried. And now I'm starting to find out that certain people aren't. As long as you know how to play and you can lock it in and listen.
Yes.
Most people are like, hey, you're good. Just do your thing.
Yes.
He's like, I just go down and take every gig. I don't care what they say.
Well, the thing is, too, is like, I've experienced this as being like a more of a sub on Broadway. It's like we put it ourselves on such a pedestal, and we a lot of times we forget. It's like the other musicians are feeling the same thing. Like oftentimes they're also subbing, like they're going to mess up too. It's not like everything's perfect and then, oh, we're just going to screw it up on the drums.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, we're all in this together and it's going to be okay.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Okay. Why don't we talk to us about,
okay.
I know. I'm all over the place.
I have the worst transitions.
I love your transitions.
There's no emotion,
dude. Okay, not to talk any kind of smack,
yeah.
Because I have mad respect for Jared Falk. But that is the one thing that I consistently Jared, if you're listening to this, there's something that he does when he's interviewing people that drives me bananas. Drives me absolutely crazy.
Yeah,
somebody like Benny Greb or a Dennis Chambers or some Matt Garska will say something in the video that's phenomenal and profound and like game changing. Mm. And you know what Jared will say?
He'll walk right over it.
He'll say, cool. So, and then just like transition to the next thing. I'm like, I know that you have to get to the next thing because you're making a lesson like that. And you're going to do the private, the behind the paywall stuff too.
Yeah.
So you have to, there's a certain things you need to fulfill. But there's got to be a better transition.
Yeah, right.
There has to be.
Yeah, exactly.
Again, all the love to Jared because Drumeo is awesome. I love them for what they're.
You're right. I've picked up on that too.
But every time I'm like, oh, like Dennis just dropped some like wit. You could go that. You could just take 5 seconds.
No.
Go. Holy cow!
Yep.
What a story. All right, I have to ask you about now. Blah blah blah.
Yeah.
Like, just give it the reverence it deserves, man.
Yeah. So can I go off the script?
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Especially when those people are in the room.
Yeah.
So let's talk about, so that's a good transition. Bernard Purdie, you've mentioned him a few times.
Yeah.
You've actually met him, right?
He's a good actually, legitimately, good friend of yours. He's actually a friend.
Yeah.
So when I started learning how to play drums, there was a video of him. I think he actually has a DVD of it, him playing, kind of talking about the Purdie shuffle. And, you know, you've seen Bernard.
I've seen that video.
Yeah.
Probably. It's hilarious.
He's got more personality than anybody should have.
Yes. Yeah. So there's a guy named Josh Minns that used to live in New York, and he owned a company called Rich Sticks. I didn't even know it was a stick company at the time. Bernard was on Facebook with him. Now, Bernard obviously doesn't do Facebook. It's his wife. She was on there and they were like, hey, man, if you can guess 3 of his nicknames, his favorite food, you win like a signed set of sticks. How about this? So I spent the whole day. I was like, dude, I knew the nicknames. And then it got late and I put fried chicken and went to bed. And the next day I was at work back in Minnesota. I was sitting in with like all my disabled people having a blast with everybody. And my phone dings and it was Josh. He's like, hey, man, congratulations. You won the Bernard thing. And I was like, oh, my gosh, dude. And everybody's like, what is wrong with you? Okay. And I was like, I just want Bernard. And they're like, who's Bernard? I'm like, oh my gosh, are you freaking kidding me, guys? And I get it. They didn't care, you know, at that time. Yeah. And so Josh starts reaching out to me via text. And he's like, hey, man, you want everything? And then he's like, hey, here, hit me up. Call me up. And so I call this guy. And I love to talk. I sometimes talk a lot. Like the guy that we went on tour with, I felt bad. I talked a lot. And he's like, bro, no, that was really good. You educated me on some things. And he's a new guy here in town. And so Josh was making fun of the twins. The dude was like, not in a rude way, like truly was not in a rude way. Like he just wouldn't shut up, but he was like, blah, 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 blah. And then like, he's like, hey man, do you know what I do? And I was like, not a clue. He's like, I'm a stick company. I was like, oh, cool. Right on. And he's like, hey, have you ever been endorsed? And I was like, ha, that's funny, dude. Like, have you seen my posts? It's like, I don't have a lot, you know? Yeah. He's like, dude, no, seriously. Like, he's like, Bernard's an artist of mine. And I've got these other guys. And he had been talking to like Vinny Caliuna. And I was like, okay. A little bit more like you're asking.
So where do I fall into this?
Yeah, like this is like the dog, you know, like I'm down here. And so he said, no, dude, just send me some videos and if we'll talk. And so found out that Josh actually wrote the Hyda rudiments. And he's gone through every stick company. He used to be with Vic Firth and ProMark and all that. And the thing he told me, he's like, I hated it because when I'd call, I was just a number. Yeah. And he said, I made a stick company that was like a family-based thing. Like you're not just a number.
Yeah.
So I sent him the videos, and the next thing you know, I was like, well, how do I meet Bernard? I didn't care about the sticks. I was like, I want to meet this guy, Bernard. You know, Bernard's 83. He just turned 83 in June. So I was like, he's like, well, let's talk the sticks. Like, so Monday, he calls me and he says, I want to sign you. I want to build you a custom stick. And he's like, the cool thing is your name is going to be right under Bernard. And I was like, you're joking with me, right? Like, this can't be real.
Yeah.
So he's like, no, it's real. And so they had a private Facebook page that we could talk to Bernard. Actually, it was his wife that was talking. So one night, I was like, hey, how can I meet Bernard? And I was living in Minnesota and there was a school called McNally Smith. Have you ever heard of that school?
I have.
Yeah. Okay. It was opened at the time. And he's like, I think Bernard's coming down there to do a clinic. And I was like, oh, I'm there. I was like, how can I meet him? And he's like, well, just hit his wife up. So I start talking to her, and she's like, you know, why don't you just call Bernard? And I was like, yeah, right. And she hands me, I get this phone number. So I call, and he's like, how's it going, son? And I was like, I just couldn't believe that I was talking to Bernard. Like, yeah. It still gives me chills to this day. I was like, this is a guy that I look up to. And I was like, it took me like 6 months to learn the Bernard Purdie shuffle, you know, yeah. And then I learned that I did most of it wrong when I did the lesson with him.
Yeah.
But he was like, yeah, like he flat out told me, he's like, I don't give lessons to people when I'm on the road because I've been treated wrong or somebody's trying to gain something or cold them to my coattails, you know, and there's just other things that, you know, were said. And I was like, okay, he goes, but there's something about you. Josh has spoke highly of you. So let's do it.
Wow.
And he goes, it's $200 for 1 hour. I was like, cool. And then so at the time, what was funny, I was like, hey, Bernard, can I bring a GoPro and a camera? He's like, this is 2018. He said, I'd rather you bring a tape deck. And now knowing Bernard as I do now, I'd have been like, dude, it's 2018, Bernard. Where am I getting a tape deck?
Right.
But he's like, you're going to lose the footage. And I was like, I still have it. And so he's like, yeah, let's do this. I said, well, could we take you out to dinner? He's like, well, we'll have to see, you know, because like there was like 200 drummers playing the Bernard Purdie shuffle and then Rocksteady.
Oh.
And there was a bunch of other drummers that were up on the stage. And so he was like, yeah, I'll come into town. I'll let you know when we're in. And then we'll rent out one of the rooms, we'll play it. And we'll just see what happens. So my buddy had just started drumming from church, had no clue who Bernard was. And he was like, hey, man, he's a plumber. He's like, I'll load up your drums in this and we'll have a blast. And I was like, you know who Bernard is, right? And Bernard was like, yeah, he can sit in the lesson. I was like, do you know how many drummers that would kill you right now?
Yeah.
To be sitting in this room and watching this. And so we meet Bernard. He came into the clinic and there was this little kid just ripping up the drums and he stopped the kid. He's like, hey, that's not how you're going to get a gig. Tune four. And he walks like an old man, but he gets on the kit and it's like, dude, no wonder you are what you are.
Yeah.
So met him, his wife, super nice. I had my stick there. He took a picture with it. I took a picture with his. Yeah, he reminds me of my dad because, you know, like at nighttime, you don't call Bernard at night. It's, you know, he's old, you know?
Yeah.
And this is no disrespect if he ever hears this. I mean this in no disrespect. He doesn't remember things, you know?
Yeah.
And so I was like, ask him like, you know, leather shoes and the snare needs to be turned off when you're playing. And I was like, okay. And it was kind of confusing with just the snare being off. That's how he practices. And then he turns on the snare. And I was like, that is so weird. And I asked him, you know, how did you learn the shuffle? And he's like, it's a train beat. And then he just magical. Well, at that point, we had to get back to the festival or whatever it was. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to go to lunch with you. Let's go get fried chicken. Well, it happened that we thought we were going to fried chicken. It turned into sushi. His favorite band is the Red Hot Chili Peppers. And like we got to just like spend a whole day. And then we came back to the festival and there was this one open spot up front. And I was like, man, I got to be all the way back there now because I was hanging with Bernard. And then the guy's like, I don't know who you are, dude, but that's your spot. And I was like, I'm a nobody. He's like, well, obviously you're not because you're hanging with this dude, Bernard. Like, you know him really well. And so it just opened up and he'll call and he'll ask me how my son's doing. Wow. He's told me like, hey, man, if you're ever in town, let's you're more than welcome to come to the house. And like I found out from his wife, like she's the one that cracks the whip. Like if people start bombarding him, she's like, get away.
Yeah.
Because there is people that try to take advantage of him and try to like, you know, get information that they don't need to be getting and then use it to hurt him.
Yeah.
And so I was shocked, man. I couldn't believe that I was on the same stick company. And then the door shut. And we still, to this day, have talked. I called him on his birthday and he remembers me. And he signed like some Modern Drummer magazines. He signed his record for me.
Mm.
And it was just like, this is nuts. Like,
what a story.
Yeah.
That's like out of a movie.
And I actually called Josh Minns the night that I was getting ready to meet him. And I said, because somebody said, dude, I've met my hero. And it sucked. Yeah. And I was like, Josh, how's this going to go? Because if he's going to be somebody, I don't want to meet him then. And he's like, dude, Bernard is the sweetest dude ever. And he really was. Like,
yeah.
And he flat out told me, he's like, yeah. Because there was somebody else that went up and said, can I get a lesson? He's like, I don't do it. He's like, well, why is that guy? He's like, don't worry about it. So it happened. And then the stick company shut. It was unfortunate. And then I got with another stick company now. Yeah. So,
wow.
Yeah.
That reminds me of, you know, Nate, when you tell the story of meeting Vinny. You know, because you're saying how Vinny was your hero. But
you mean Virgil?
Virgil, sorry, not Vinny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've never met Vinny.
Yeah.
V, yeah. True. Well, yeah, yes, it is like that because I had the same thing. I'm like,
yeah,
I really hope this guy is not a dick.
Yeah.
And he was awesome.
Yeah.
Like, okay, this guy's Really, and I
don't,
really cool.
And I don't do it to name drop him. I legitimately consider Bernard a friend.
Yeah.
Like, he is, I don't know, just, it was just so cool to meet somebody that has done what he's done.
Yeah.
And hearing how he likes
Chili Peppers.
Yeah,
peppers.
Like Chad and him have hung out, and like Aretha Franklin stories, and just hearing what he's done is like, holy moly.
Yeah.
You know?
So back to that one-on-one lesson that you had, which sounds like just incredible.
It was intense.
Beyond like the 2 and 4, right? What was sort of a takeaway from that lesson? If you had to look back at maybe one other thing.
One thing I think for me, like, even though Bernard, he doesn't do a lot of fancy stuff, it literally is just keep it simple and play to the singer. You're not there to show off. You're there to compliment it. You're working for them and not you. And some things I was kind of confused on because I've not taken lessons, and he would say things that I didn't fully understand. And I'd ask him, and he was just like, get my DVD. I was like, that's not, I watched it on the DVD. That's what I'm asking you. But I left it alone. You know, that was one thing. So like, he said something about balance, and I couldn't understand what he meant. Like, cause I play pretty spread out, and he was like, you need to bring it in. And so maybe that's what he meant. And I just never had taken maybe lessons to understand some of the things, which maybe that was wrong, but I was like, I'm not missing this opportunity.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, like he worked with this, like how to like use the snare off and different, and some of the things I just didn't understand. I'm just going to be real. Like, I was like, I don't know what that means, but okay.
Yeah.
I know there was this like 16th note thing that he did. And I was like, hey, how did you do that? And he's like, just get my DVD.
I
was like, well, that's where I saw it at. That's why I'm asking you, because I can't figure it out on the DVD. Yeah. And just kept going back to it. I was like, okay, cool, whatever.
Yeah.
I was like, whatever.
Just get the DVD.
Yeah, yeah. So I was grateful for it.
I'm going to start saying that.
Yeah.
Well, next time I do a chop and someone goes, what was that? I just get my DVD, bro.
Yeah. But I was super grateful. I mean, and he's helped me, you know, like he's talked to me about the industry, you know, like, yeah, dude, it's... He's even admitted to me, he's like, dude, you got to have confidence, but there's a good way of doing it and a bad way. And he's even admitted that, like, he was cocky, and there was a time when he needed to shut his mouth. And I was like, wow, like hearing that's cool to me to see. It taught me, you know, like that, those kind of things. And
yeah,
like,
sure. So, yeah, all the things away from the drum set itself.
Yeah.
Just how to be a good person. And
you know what I would argue though?
What's that?
And this is just my own personal opinion. And it seems to be, not that being cocky is something that you need or that it's necessarily good.
Yep.
But some of the best players, some of the highest performers in everything have some of that, like they believe that they're the best.
Oh yeah.
And it makes them better. Their 100%. Belief, their confidence that it's they like a are swagger the best
thing too.
Yeah.
That's true. Just before this, I was watching the Jeter documentary. It's a series. So I think there might be 10 episodes now. But that's Jeter's whole thing. Like, in high school, he's like, I'm going to be the best player. I'm going to be in the Yankees. Like, I'm going to be the best baseball player.
Oh, wow.
And like, he was definitely cocky, but like that, and he talks about how that mentality actually was very like tangible and like actually helped him perform better.
Yeah.
So I agree with that, actually. But it is a fine balance, you know?
Yeah.
Do you know who Zlatan Ibrahimovic is? Ibrahimovic?
Right. Ibrahimovic.
He's a soccer player. Kill monster.
I think you've mentioned this guy before,
okay,
right?
Yeah. Yeah, he's like...
And that was what he would say.
Yeah, he's like, in interviews, they're asking him, like, well, who's the best kicker in the league? Well, he's like, this person's good. He's really good, really, really good. And like, well, I noticed you didn't mention yourself. He's like, of course. He's like, because... They're men. I'm a lion. It's like, I wouldn't compare myself to, like, of course I'm better than they are.
Yeah.
I'm like, whoa. And he's a monster. Like, I think I said it in the other podcast. He's like, he took out, because most players take out an ad when they leave a team and they, like, they thank the city. And he took out an ad when he went to LA. He said, dear Los Angeles, you're welcome. And that was his ad.
Like, I love
the
that.
Balls on this guy. I'm like, there's something. For Purdie to admit, maybe he was arrogant and maybe that went too far. But I would argue that some of that cockiness, you can hear it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
And it's like,
that's a good point. Yeah.
Yes.
Because that can come out when you're playing. There's you away from the drums of being cocky, which is maybe very negative. But having that come out when you're playing, that confidence.
Oh, yeah.
People pick up on that.
Well, it's just like the Rose Namajunas. Remember when she came out to fight?
Yes.
I'm the best. Same with Amanda Nunes just recently.
Yeah.
I mean, she got beat. At first, I was hoping she was going to get beat because she was claiming COVID. Did she work that girl? Did you watch that last time?
I didn't watch it, but I know.
That's why she's the GOAT. I mean, I'm like, no wonder you are the way you are.
Yeah.
So, I guess.
And Rose, great example because also a really sweet person.
Yeah.
But like, I'm the best. Going in like a monster and then coming out like, I can be a normal human again.
Yeah. Yeah. So I guess it makes sense that what you're saying.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that was cool. That was the first endorsement. I didn't know. I thought it was weird having one of those.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Snareweight's another one of mine that I'm super thankful for. They've done some really cool things. Like, this is, if you mind, if I share the story real quick.
Of course.
Please. There was this gentleman. He's 21 years old. He's a good friend of mine. He's got a rare disease that's killing him. Mm. And Mayo Clinic in Rochester is keeping him alive since he was 11. Mm. His name's Seth Bales. Super cool kid. He doesn't complain once. Like, he actually goes into the children's hospital and shares. And, like, he's amazing family. So I went and signed a Soul Tone, like everybody does. Mm-hmm. No offense. Like, yeah. I learned real quick.
Yeah.
And when we moved here, I met Seth back in Minnesota. There was a guy named Sean Fagan. They had the studio and they were like, hey, man, this kid's coming in. We're going to do a private show for him. And yeah, I found out he was a drummer. And he was like, his mom says he has like chemo brain. That he's kind of like, he's in his 20s, but he acts like a kid. Like, you can't, not like even a kid, but he doesn't comprehend things. Mm. And so we connected very closely. Like, I told him, dude, you can call me anytime. You'll never bother me. If it's a question you need to answer, I will figure it out. If I don't know it, I live here in Nashville. There's somebody that's going to help me figure it out, and we're going to get it to you.
Yeah.
And so one day he had called me about the snare weight. I had bought snare weight. It was actually kind of funny. That girl that's on YouTube, Christina, the one that does all those covers. Do you know who I'm talking about? She's with HAC and like Zildjian.
Yeah, I do. Shirano, I think her last name is.
Yes, yep. She had this snare weight thing on her snare. And I was like, I hate moon gels. I don't like gook up. And I kept seeing this thing. And I was like, what is that? And I reached out to her and she reached back to me and she's like, it's snare weight. And I was like, okay. So I bought the thing and I fell in love with it. And then they reached out to me and said, hey man, would you like to like send us a video and we'll think about signing maybe. And I was like, okay. And they came back with like, hey, you need to hit your toms a little harder. But we like what you do, so let's get you signed. And I was like, oh, whoa, that's really cool. Yeah. And
I love that. Good critique and a little bit of encouragement. Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was like, cool, man. And so I got with this company, and legitimately, I will say they are the coolest people ever. So Seth reached out to me one day. He's like, hey, my snare rings a lot. What do I do about it? I said, hey, man, let's get you a snare weight. And for some reason, something compelled me to reach out to the guy that was in, he lives in San Francisco. He does all their social. He was like, hey, man, I'm in Thailand. I got stuck here during COVID. He'd been there for a long time. His wife lived there and they got stuck there. And so we were reaching back and forth. I said, hey, I got this guy. And can I share his story with you? I shared everything. And they're like, we're going to endorse him fully. And I was like, what?
That's cool.
And it just, my buddy just started freaking out. He's like, what's an endorsement? You know, because he doesn't play full time. He can only play for so long and then he's out of breath and he has seizures and he gets tube fed. And so Seth is a rock star to me. Like, I will do anything for this kid. Like, I brought him up on stage. We've played multiple drum sets together. And so he got a full endorsement with Snareway. And I was like, this is a company I want to be with. Wow. When you go above and beyond,
that's a cool story.
And not look at it like you have to have a number.
Yeah.
They're helping this kid. And it wasn't a pity thing. They were like, no, we love him. Yeah. They sent him all this stuff. And so I went back in August because I'm an ordained minister and I was going to do a wedding for my brother-in-law. And I called his mom. I said, so this is really cool about symbols. I think you guys had talked about gear one time. So back up where I started with drums, I came with a Meinl. I didn't know what Meinl was. Yeah, right. Not a clue. Everybody's using Zildjian. I was like, I want Zildjian because it's cool.
Yeah.
And then nothing against it. I just didn't like it anymore. Like, the A customs were crappy. There's too much ring. And then I started learning about Benny Greb and these dudes. And I was like, Meinl. And I had this symbol that was Meinl. It broke. And I stuck it in a box and I found it. I was like, what is this symbol? And then I started YouTube and I was like, I want to go back to Meinl. So I went and got the dual series and I called up my buddy. I found out, he's like, I broke all my cymbals. And he gets there was a buddy of his that got killed. And so the mom gave him all his drums and they give him money to help buy stuff. And I called his mom. I said, hey, I'm going to be coming in August. And he comes they live in Wisconsin. So they have to come quite a bit to Mayo Clinic because they got to test him and make sure he's still, you know, they're keeping him alive.
Yeah.
And I was like, hey, how would you be willing to bring him down and I'll surprise him with these symbols? I'm going to give him every single Soul Tone symbol I have. And it had my little logo on it because he's obsessed with the critter. And she's like, actually, it's his birthday and we're going to be down there. And I was like, are you serious? Let's do it. And so I went to this house. He didn't know I was there, and he came around the corner and he just lost. And I said, "Hey man, I got a gift for you." And he's like, "What's up?" I gave him every single soul ton. He just lost. He's like, and I'm not doing it to like gain anything or like pat me on the back. I would legitimately, that this kid goes through. I mean, like I was telling this to this guy, like I complain about the stupidest little things.
Yeah. This kid's going through hell on earth.
Yeah.
He's like, trying to survive.
And he doesn't complain once. Like he legitimately does not complain. He goes out and serves.
Yeah.
It's like, here I am complaining. I mean, you know, just over the stupidest little things that like, so
puts it in perspective.
I'm so grateful for Snareways. Legitimately, they went above and beyond. And I was like, dude, hands down. And then Mia Moore is another company I'm with. It's a stick company. Mm-hmm. And it's a family. His name's Barry Moore. And he just got done having cancer and survived it. And his kids have had cancer. And he's gone through a lot. And he went out and he builds a snare. And he hands it to Seth. I want to support Seth. Here's a snare. And Seth is like, what the heck, dude? And I'm like, so those are the companies that I like to go towards, you know.
Having that real personal connection.
And that's what Bernard said. I said, why? You're such a big name. Like, nothing against Rich Sticks, but it's not Vic Firth. It's not these big names. And he goes, because it's family.
Yeah.
I was like, that makes sense. It made total sense to me. So that's why I try to, I mean, don't get me wrong, I'd love to be with Meinl. So if you hear this, Meinl.
You're listening?
Nate's a Meinl artist.
Yeah, so yeah, you know, like I mean, even if I didn't, I'm still gonna play them. I love them. Like that's what I like to play, and it's cool. Like I told it to somebody, and like that's really cool. Actually, that you went back to like what you actually play. You know, not because of popularity.
Yeah.
So
that was, dude, and that's kind of a bit of the experience I had with Zildjian. So I'm like, yeah, I'm like Zildjian's kind of like that's the way to go, right? And I got a bunch, and I was like, I actually got to the point where I was like, it happened to me slowly, where I was like, I don't like any of these sounds I'm getting.
Yeah.
I mean, there's clearly a few exceptions, and I'm not saying they make bad cymbals, obviously.
No.
But I was just like, I just got to the point where I was like, I actually don't, these aren't the sounds I want.
Yeah. That's it. Yeah. That's how
that should always be the first baseline. That's a good discussion just in terms of talking about endorsements and like, looking for that personable connection with the company. I think it's hard. I mean, obviously, I work for a big brand as Pearl, and I'm definitely biased there. But we definitely do treat, you know, all of our artists kind of as a family, and like we're very have those connections with every single artist. But there's companies that don't do that, and it's definitely
something to be mindful of. Jim actually told me that too, because I remember somebody asking Jim, like, I just want an endorsement. He's like, why?
Yeah, why?
And it's because most people think it's free.
It's not free,
and it's not free. I still pay for the stuff.
Yeah,
it's the experience of it. Like, are you? Why do you want it? Like, you really value the, you know, and so. That's why I play what I play.
Yeah.
Well, and people don't understand that they're what responsibility that is. Like, oh yeah, well, endorsement one, they think that means free gear, which it can.
Yeah.
But it doesn't necessarily mean that. And then the other thing is that, like, well, yeah, and then that, like, that frees me up in this way. Like, actually, that gives you a responsibility to play their stuff. And if you're doing any kind of promotional material, you better not be playing other stuff.
No.
Like, you'd be surprised at how often that is an issue.
Oh yeah.
I'm not gonna name any names, but sometimes it's very it's not like egregious, because we oftentimes work with like university, you know, orchestral musicians where they're playing what is on the stage and they don't have any control over that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, that's a great point. Like, it is, you know, there's a contractual agreement, and it is like a relationship, and you know, they do have that responsibility.
Well, like with Mia Moore, so Mia is Barry's wife's name, and. You know, I stayed with Rich Stick till the door closed. I didn't jump. There was a lot of dudes that jumped. Mm. And Mia, you know, Barry came out. He's like, hey, man, try this stick. And I was like, I don't really like that stick. You know, it was maple. And then I felt like what he had to offer was great. And he told me flat out, he's like, dude, it has my wife's name on it. So respect my stick. It's my brand. And he says he's fired guys off there, like, because they were just not representing him and his wife. And so I'm like, hey, you're cool, man.
I dig that.
Yeah, and he's done it, you know, and I'm grateful for him. You know, he's, you know, when the thing happened with my sister and other things, I can call him, and it's not about the stick.
Right.
It's legitimate. Like, he's called me, like, hey, man, can you pray for me? I'm going through cancer. Like, I'm literally, like, I need help. That's what I love about being with the companies that I'm with.
Yeah.
It's not about, it is, but it isn't. You know, there's that relationship, and I love that.
Yeah, it's great.
So, man. I'm just trying to make it, you know. I try not to get discouraged. I mean, I just read a text just recently that I guess I lost one of my really good gigs tonight. And I was like, well, that stunk.
Tonight?
Yeah. They gave it to somebody else because I couldn't. I was like, oh, man. So now I'm back to square one. And it's like, what am I doing? But
yeah,
I'm not going to stop.
Yeah, I love that. That's kind of been the theme of this whole, your story, I feel like, has just been staying super positive. And you've had so many challenges, more so than most, especially with your personal life. And
And the flood, which we haven't talked about on this at all.
Yeah.
Well, you want me to tell? I was attacked by a guy with a machete last year.
What the fuck? What?
Yeah, it was before all that, right?
Yeah, I mean, I can share this. It doesn't bother me, but I lost a twin sister to drug overdose. It was horrible. And this company right here, it's called Straight Edge for Christ. Cool dude. He sponsors me. But this dude, my neighbors have warned me about him. He was just a little man. And he took a blade to my arm, put me down, punched a girl in the face, caught me right here. And he's out. He's out. Literally out. And I guess this would be good to, tell people this. Like, I've legitimately gone through hell. Like, legitimately. My wife's, waiting for me to die for a heart attack last year. She's like, you have so much stress on you. Like, I mean, cousins were involved and I've had my life threatened and I had the Marines after me because they used money they weren't supposed to use. Like that was scary to have the Marine call you and say, where'd that money go? And I was like, I don't know. Like, I'm just the twin brother, you know? And so, I'm not gonna lie. There's challenges where I'm like, I just want to call it and be done. Like, I'll go get a regular job. I have a CDL. I'll go drive truck. Yeah. But then I can't. My wife's like, that's not who you were created. And so those are some huge challenges, but I've never stopped. Mm-hmm. But my wife would say different. Like, if you were to ask my wife, I annoy the crap out of her, but she's the biggest support in my life. She really is. She's like, go ahead and quit and see what happens. You're not going to be happy.
Yeah.
And so then it's like, okay, you're right. So if anybody got anything out of this, I would say, don't quit. No matter what challenges you are, you got to try. And if you don't try, that's your own fault.
Yeah.
Because I see people that are young and they just don't want to work or something. It's like, to get better at something, you have to.
Yeah.
That's how you have to.
Yeah, I love that. And then if it doesn't work out, you tried. You don't have that regret.
Yeah. No, yeah. Like,
because that's one of the biggest things that, like, older people, you know, will say, like, I have regret. And at that point, it's too late.
Yeah.
All the things you wish you would have done.
Yeah. So, like this guy, I'm not going to mention his name. It was like, I just got the text. And I was like, oh, that royally sucked. That was a good paying gig. But I was like, okay, whatever, dude. There's something better out there. I know. Yeah. I know there is. There's got to be. I didn't move here for nothing.
Yeah.
I didn't. And I'm not going to quit. I know there's drummers that can eat me alive, but I know I'm going to get there. I just got to keep going for it. I do lift if I have to, you know, I'll do whatever it takes.
Yeah.
So
that's super inspirational. Yeah. I'm glad we could have you on and you know, share your story.
Yeah. I appreciate it. And like I said, I know I got a little deep into the personal life, but I think that helps people. I think they need to hear that.
Oh, for sure.
Well, that's my favorite part.
Yeah. I think they do.
Especially on this podcast is not only talking about drums, like it's all the other stuff
that
makes us who we are.
Yeah.
My desire for this podcast has always been for that to be the kind of focal point. I'm like, drums are almost like we can just, as people in the room, all agree that we love.
Yeah. It's like, that's why you're here in the first place. You're a drummer. Okay.
Next. Like, cool. Like, yeah. So tell me about your life. Like, because I want non-drummers listening to be interested.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, if we just talked about like stick sizes and like, well, do you prefer clear coated heads and why? Like, we can talk about that, but it's like, it's 20% that and 80% the other stuff.
Like today the guy was asking me in the car, he's like, what do you hope somebody gets out of this? And I said, honestly, never gonna give up. Like, I have to share those stories. Like, people here, they're like, I can't believe you haven't just like dropped dead or murdered somebody.
Yeah.
Cause I even called the girl out that watched my sister pass and she was a nationwide drug dealer. And I was like, you watched her and shame on you and get right with Jesus is what I told her. I said, I serve a merciful God. And she's like, yeah, whatever. But I know like those challenges, those are just challenges and I can get over them.
Yeah.
And you know, I guess the biggest thing I would say, if somebody's struggling with that kind of stuff, you know, drugs or anything, get help, man.
Yeah.
Try to get help. You got it. Like if you're dealing with depression and stuff like that, cause my sister did, you know, gotta get help.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's resources out there, especially now.
So like, I can't let it get me down. I just keep moving forward. If somebody, like, you know, like I said, if somebody treats me bad, I just move on. I don't need those people in my life. I need to have people that are going to encourage and be positive and just roll with it. So
I talked with somebody about that today at work at Tootsie's. They're like, yeah. I'm like, why are you always working? Well, if I stop working, then I start having these thoughts about taking my own life. I was like, you need to go talk to somebody now.
Like,
don't think for a second that there's any kind of shame in that. Like,
no.
It's the opposite. If you don't do that, that is a shame.
Yeah, it really is. Because you're going to, you know, I get it, man. There's always a way out. I don't care who you are.
Yeah.
There always is. And if you don't, you're going to affect everybody. You will. It really will. I mean,
you're lying to yourself if you think, like, no one will care. Like, that
that's a bunch of crap, dude. Yeah. There's not one day I can't think. I mean, you lose a sibling, but that was just a twin, dude. Yeah. I don't even celebrate my birthdays anymore because it's just weird. Yeah. But it is what it is, you know, and I just keep moving forward.
Love it.
Yeah, man. I appreciate y'all having me on here.
Of course.
Thanks for listening to this episode of the Nashville Drummers Podcast. If you liked it, please consider leaving us a review on the Apple Podcast app.
Also, check out our new website, NashvilleDrummersPodcast.com. And if you're not already following us on Instagram, you can follow us at Nashville Drummers Podcast.
This episode was recorded at Diamond Sound Studios, located in Nashville, Tennessee.
Sponsored by Music Lab Nashville, production by The Wise Company.
A very special thanks to Bernard Purdie for allowing us at Critter's behest to use some of his tracks in this podcast. This song we're listening to now is Cool Down, and the one you heard in the intro is called Elevate.
Thank you for listening, and we'll see you in the next episode.